So my presentation will have about four parts. And let's think about four lectures, which are based mostly on international fracture mechanics summer schools. So as in parallel to what you just heard from Professor Nicky Fortune, we did have 10 fracture mechanics summer schools in Serbia and also ex Yugoslavia, starting from 1980 up to 2008. Last two of them are published in English. Those are 8, 9, and 10. They are available at ESSIS website, and we do have also a couple of copies here if somebody wishes to have hard copy as well. From the content wise, which is based on my personal experience, I will show you how fracture mechanics is applied in failure analysis. That will be the first part. Then, since we would like to avoid such situations, I will try to explain how we apply fracture mechanics to assess structural integrity, and then how to assess fatigue life, and finally how do we apply nonlinear fracture mechanics, all in favor of avoiding failures. Example or case study that I will briefly show you is about carriage monoblock wheel that fractured radially in the zone corresponding to chuck marks. Not very much important. What is important? Stress concentration area. It has happened in 1998. It has happened in a period between installation in January and about May the same year, after reducing the diameter due to wear, and then finally failure when diameter was about 890, starting from initial 920. A gap of about 5 millimeters that was present in fracture area is also important, because it indicates the presence of compressive stresses prior to fatigue, at least in this wheel. And also another facts which are interesting and important. First of all, as it turned out, also one of the most important is the influence of brake show insert, because traces which are found later indicated that it was a kind of a hard breaking, and also it indicated even thermal effects. That was something of an alarm, because it actually should have not happened. Breaking should not be that intensive, so all these marks, visible traces, actually indicated some problems with thermal stresses as well. But then again, there were another wheels with traces of breaking, but without stress concentration. So, first important effect is stress concentration, and the second one so far is thermal stress due to breaking. Now this is the monoblock wheel in two pieces with the gap that I just mentioned. This is the braking system. And here you can see fatigue, crack, fatigue crack, which, as you probably already know, should be blamed for this failure, and we'll see in what way and was it really so. So for a failure analysis, a couple of actions were taken, starting with establishment of the crack growth rate,
caused by fatigue, because it was pretty obvious for any experienced researcher or investigator that it was fatigue. Then it was interesting also to assess whether this crack or these cracks could have been detected before fracture. So how to deal later on. Then again, of course, as in failure analysis, as typical for failure analysis, sample was used to determine crack growth and other properties, and then another sample was used for visual inspection, leading to already mentioned crack, which is quite obvious. Then some ridges or scores in the rest of the rim and flange, typical signs of brittle fracture. And finally, just the traces of plastic deformation. So it was more or less typical fatigue in combination with brittle fracture. Also, scanning electron microscope was used as yet another proof that there were no other important material defects or faults, and that plastic deformation was really negligible. And finally, of course, you always want to know about the material. Its chemical composition was in accordance with regulations, with standards, and there was no problem in design of the wheel. Testing of fatigue was very important, and it practically revealed immediately what the problem was. It was done according to the standard. It was done by using three-point bending standard Sharpie specimens. You saw how it should have been done already in the first lecture. We have used high-frequency pulsating machine in load control mode, and we obtained diagram like this. On the x-axis, there is stress intensity range factor, and depending on it, there is crack growth rate on ordinate. Whoever did testing like this, you recognize at once that, of course, it depends always on the scaling, but this is, how to say, very vertical, or better to say, crack growth rate is very high, surprisingly high. More concrete, there was a threshold of about 18 of these operant units, megapascal square root meter, up to the final value of 20, so here it is 18, here it is 20. And the number of cycles spent for crack initiation was 200,000, which was not so bad, but the number of cycles for crack growth and final fracture was really relatively small, surprisingly small. So at once we can conclude that material from the point of view of fatigue is not a very good one. As I already mentioned, plastic deformation was negligible, existing only near bed surface, near working surface. Existence of ridges also indicate initial fracture location. They were toward it, so typical for fatigue. And microscopic characteristics were in accordance with this, since, as already mentioned, scanning electron microscopy also hasn't indicated plastic deformation in any important quantity. So, probably the scenario was like two steps. First, fatigue crack appeared, initiated, and then further developed in a somewhat stable manner up to critical value. And then in the second phase, under the effect of quasi-static loading, the unstable fatigue crack propagation preceded the final fracture failure. So the first phase is something typical. There is initial fatigue crack, and then it grows up to the critical value. Critical value is quasi-static value, something that corresponds to the brittle rupture occurrence, something that corresponds to K1C, fracture toughness. Now, of course, fatigue test and its loading does not represent exactly the real life. There are some important differences, but anyhow, it was the purpose of this analysis was to explain the failure, so we didn't have to replicate exactly the loading, but we had to take into account that in real life there was very important contribution from thermal stresses, even thermal shock, and also from residual stresses, and then of course what is usual mechanical loading in this case. So without going into much details, we don't have time, and you can find it in the literature, we concluded at this point that combined action of all mentioned stresses, mechanical, thermal, residual, was obviously such that resulting cycle stress can cause initial fatigue crack, and then also, of course, in the highest stress concentration area, and then the crack would develop to the critical size. That was, how to say, qualitative analysis. Now for the quantitative analysis, to get some numbers, as Professor Landis also mentioned, to be a strength of fracture mechanics, we did testing in fracture toughness using 30 millimeter thick CT specimens and obtained about 105 megapascals per root meter. Anyhow, the requirement for K1C was not satisfied. We didn't have material which would be thicker than that, so we calculated how thick it should have been and obtained, if I'm not wrong, about 60 millimeters, and for that, no, 48, yeah, it was 48, and for that value, fracture toughness would have been, but not realistically, just by extrapolation, 64.2. So the real fracture toughness, as we concluded, is in between these two values. Now for the fatigue test, it was already, as already mentioned, 20,000 cycles for crack propagation, and corresponding stress range for that was 87 megapascals, which is much lower for the yield stress, but it's realistic in this case. So operational or working stress can be as high as this when we take into account all of loadings, mechanical, thermal, and residual. So we also made some analysis about the crack itself, how it would behave, I will show it soon, and the purpose was to evaluate, calculate remote tensile stress. So now I'm dealing with quasi-static conditions. We are interested in this value to analyze final fracture. This was the wrong one. So we here have a model of crack. I will explain it in a couple of more details soon, and some relatively simple, although lengthy calculation about stress and stress intensity factor correlated by geometry factors and, of course, crack length. In this case, crack is so-called surface crack. There is length and depth, or whatever we call it. But irrespective of that, the important fact here is that remote stress that would cause brittle fracture is about 282.5 megapascals, and that is that was calculated with k taken as being the minimum k1c, even though it's a bit fictional, but that's what we had at our hands. Now, once again, this was the failed part of it, and this is the model. So just think about rotating it 90 degrees to be in the same position as this, and then you can see that C is actually this value, and A is actually this one. So this is the thickness, and for width we have taken this dimension. So once we had all this at our hands, we concluded that this is about the stress amplitude, which is responsible for delta K and for the fatigue crack, initiation and growth. And then we also could conclude, analyzing fatigue behavior, that 20,000 cycles is too small period of time to really monitor crack growth. So one of the tasks of the analysis was to estimate if in the future there is a possibility to monitor crack growth, but the conclusion was that it's really not practical, it's almost impossible, and that we should take care more focus on not having initial cracks than healing it afterwards. So these are conclusions. Fatigue crack emerged under the influence of cycle stresses induced by breaking and of course at the stress concentration location. Fatigue crack propagated under the same cycle stresses. It was practically not possible to monitor it. Then unstable quasi-static propagation caused the maximal tensile stress in single breaking cycles because more detailed finite element analysis revealed that this stress level was easily achieved by breaking system that was used. It was a bit of surprise as well because you can see this is more than a half of the yield strength. This is not something that you expect from a breaking process. So, general conclusion was that we did have combination of material with extremely low resistance to fatigue crack growth, and then a breaking system producing too high tensile stresses and also cyclic stresses. So with these all combinations and stress concentration due to Chuck Marks, we did get unexpected failure of a wheel. Following actions, the most important part of the analysis is to change machining practice to avoid stress concentration, to change braking system if possible, and then also to have a more detailed analysis of stress state. Now, this single one probably solved the problem, but anyhow, as in all engineering problems, something like stress analysis should always be done, not just rely on relatively simple engineering predictions of stress state, but nowadays with finite element method or any other numerical method, we really should always do at least some stress analysis. So that was a situation that we would like to avoid. Three remaining parts of my talk will be devoted to how to avoid a situation like this, more or less. You will see in the first case, it's not exactly like that, but it's very important. Case, it is something which I put under the title Application of Fracture Mechanics in Assessment of Structural Integrity. It is something that relates well to the famous fracture mechanics triangle. So, what do we have here? Applied stress
that's loading, fracture toughness, that's material, and crack dimensions, that is crack itself. If we know two corners of this triangle, we can evaluate the third one. So if we find any defect, and especially if we find a defect which is non-acceptable according to standards, then we can use fracture mechanics principles by knowing applied stress and knowing material behavior to estimate the importance of such an effect, or more concretely, to say if that defect is endangering our construction, or hopefully that our construction can live on even with the presence of unacceptable defects in, let's say, weldments. That's in a way typical. So what I just told you is briefly described here, and first it was applied in the famous case of pipeline going from Alaska to the continental USA, where non-destructive testing revealed extremely large number of defects. We had a lot of talks about this during our fracture mechanics summer schools, and at one point somebody told us that the cost of repair would be about 90% of building a new pipeline. So that was a situation really to try to apply fracture mechanics and to obey to the results. So institution in charge, and it was at that time National Bureau of Standards, later on National Institute of Standards and Technology in Boulder, Colorado, was asked to assess structural integrity. Not as explicitly and clearly as they just said, they were actually asked to evaluate the effect of all these many defects which were unacceptable according to standards. So, detailed analysis of fracture mechanics parameters, mostly based on crack tip opening displacement parameter, which you heard about, and including assessment of crack growth, driving force on one hand, and resistance of material on the other hand, that is elastic plastic fracture mechanics. So, this kind of analysis led to the conclusion that only about, I think, 5 up to 10% of these required repairs really had to be done. So for all other unacceptable defects, it was concluded that thanks to this research, analysis of fracture mechanics is an acceptable base for admissible exception from the existing standards under certain circumstances, which are as follows. Such analysis has to provide convincing and conservative assessment of structural integrity. Actually, the term was just about to be introduced and furthermore used. So this was practically the beginning of application of fracture mechanics to structural integrity assessment. So, as you already can have impression like that, it frequently happens that non-destructive tests reveal a crack or similar defect, crack-like defect, for which we should know its possible effects on a construction. Of course, we should also take into account sensitivity of the equipment, because In that case, we can even analyze our construction, which has no defects. We can simply say there could be a defect inside which has not been revealed, and the size of that defect is then equal to the sensitivity of the equipment. So we can use fracture mechanics parameters even at the design phase. Now, from the linear elastic fracture mechanics point of view, structure integrity is simple to evaluate, at least looking at this equation. So if the stress intensity factor is less than fracture toughness, structure integrity is not threatened. And in the opposite case, structure integrity is threatened due to possibility of brittle fracture, but knowing that stress intensity factor and fracture toughness were evaluated in conservative way, so that this is as big as possible and this as small as possible, by applying this reasoning, we are not proving that something will fail. We are just not capable of proving that it will not fail. But if we get results like this, and we used conservative assumptions all the way, then we are sure that structural integrity is not jeopardized. A bit more complicated is application of elastic plastic fracture mechanics. To start with, we have two options, which of course converge to the same solution and same principles. One is, as you heard, J integral, which is conservation law, which has sound physical base. And then there is crack tip opening displacement, which does not have the same sound physical basis, but it's very practical, and we deal with it something like use and don't excuse, because practical life has shown it's very valuable parameter as well. And on the other hand side, we do know how to correlate J and CTO2. One very practical way of assessing not only linear elastic behavior, but also to include some of plasticity based on CTOD, is to use failure assessment diagram. This is a very, I would say, simple engineering tool, at least in its basic mode. It is practically a diagram, as shown here, which has a limit curve that separates safe region, which is whole area below limit curve, and unsafe region. On the axis, there is a parameter which is non-dimensional measure of plastic behavior. It is simply a ratio between net stress and critical stress. Critical stress can be yield stress, or tensile strength, or maybe something in between. On the coordinate, there is another non-dimensional parameter, KR, which is a ratio between K1, stress intensity factor, and K1C, fracture toughness. So both of them are critical when they reach 1. So this point, without any plasticity, is critical from linear elastic fracture mechanics point of view. And this one here is critical from the point of plastic collapse. We can have a situation which is not dangerous in the sense of linear elasticity, but still can produce plastic collapse. In between these two points, there is a limit curve, which is given here, which correlates KR and SR, and which can be used for the prediction. Once we calculate coordinates SR and KR for a certain problem, if we get a point here inside below limit curve, then our construction is safe. In the opposite case, we do not know if it will fail, but certainly it's not safe.
So now, how do we proceed? How do we apply? In a concrete case, the problem that arose almost 20 years ago was a pressure vessel in hydroelectric power plant Bajina Bašta in Serbia, and there were about 3 crack-like defects, at least that was our assumption. In real life, those were lack of penetration or some similar defects, which were ultrasonically detected as a bit of a strange was that they were detected about 20 years after pressure vessel already worked with no problem. It was just a regular NDT, and surprisingly, they found some defects. One possible explanation, why not at the very beginning? Well, techniques of NDT was not so good as later on. So we had to deal with this. On the other hand side, we knew that if something worked for 20 years without problem and it is under static loading, then what's the problem? But anyhow, since NDT revealed unacceptable defects, we had to deal with it. So it was a situation similar to the one that I just talked about, a pipeline from Alaska to Central USA. So these three, which I will just focus one of them, were, as I told you, in welded joints, of course, as I mentioned previously, and it was about lack of penetration here, it was about lack of side wall fusion, and once again, lack of penetration. More concretely, I will focus on defect, which was, just to remind you, found somewhere here. So in the longitudinal welded joint, close to the cover, so possible bending effects to be taken into account, and with the following geometry. First of all, vessel was about 15 millimeters thick with diameter more than 2 meters. Material was micro alloyed, low alloyed steel with high strength steel, a bit sensitive to cracking. And crack geometry, at least how we presented it, was 60 millimeters long, 2 millimeters wide, direction along the weld, and location in the root. Loading, design loading was 81 bar, and no data about residual stresses. That turned out to be important fact. So we assumed that the maximum possible value, according to experience, even to theory, would be, should be included in this analysis, and that was about 40% of the yield strength, which is 200 megapascals, since the yield strength is about 500. That is the highest value transversal to weld, and that direction is relevant for the analysis. We are looking always for the opening mode as the most critical one. The most sensitive or most critical point here was about fracture toughness, because we did not have any material to test it. But fortunately, there were extensive, even research, even a doctoral thesis, about behavior of this very same steel. So, taking into account all the results, we concluded that this is the minimum toughness value in the weld metal, more concretely in the heat affected zone, so weld metal itself could be only better than this. So this sketch now is very important. If you make a cross section through the pressure vessel, through that cylindrically shaped pressure vessel, you can actually reduce your case to the simple remote tension, a bit of curvature, which is negligible, so you can consider this as a straight plate, and then central crack 2 millimeters, thickness 50, so this reduces to the simplest possible case, the one that even Griffith considered 100 and more years ago. So the real defect, which is lack of penetration, is now transformed or modeled as true crack, because we simply supposed it goes all the way, although it didn't, but it's a conservative approach. And we have a situation which is as simple as shown, and which leads us to the stress intensity factor of about 663 megapascals per root meters. Knowing the fracture toughness, it is easy to conclude that we are at about 42% of its minimal value. So, for the coordinate, now our coordinate is 0.42. For the stress, it seems that I lost the stress analysis somewhere, which is quite strange. But anyhow, we are also, okay, this is, sorry, I found it. This is stress analysis. So net stress, net section stress for that defect is something like very simple pressure times radius divided by thickness, but also multiplied by factor which takes into account crack itself, that is net reduction of the cross section. Taking into account concrete data, including the critical stress, which we interpreted here as the half value between yield stress and tensile strength, we get the other coordinate, x coordinate, which is 0.33. So, by knowing this, and not going now to repeat this analysis for the second and the third effect, we end up with failure assessment diagram as shown here. All 3 points are in the safe region. So our conclusion was accepted by the authorities, and ever since 1998, these storage tanks, these pressure vessels, worked with no problem. Even in the following NDT evaluations, they could not find all of the defects that they found at 1 point. So, we can conclude that relatively simple engineering tools like failure assessment diagram, which are based on fracture mechanics principles and which are used in a conservative way, both from the side of the loading analysis and material properties, can be used and that is a real option. That is something that is 100% sure. There is no doubt that if this analysis shows a safe construction, it is really a safe construction. You don't need to worry if something will go wrong. There is yet another example which doesn't lead to the same conclusion, but since we are limited in time and I do have two more topics to cover, I would skip over this one, you can read it about it, and then we can have a very short break, 5 minutes, and continue so that we do not interfere with the lunch after 12. So, 5 minutes break.
Okay, I think we should proceed. It's not completely different, by the way, but we will deal now with the fatigue, so with the crack growth after it has been initiated, or even if it does not exist. So some important names or terms that I will be using are given here, like fatigue crack growth rate, then related to that and already mentioned Paris law, old Paris. fatigue life, residual life, that's about the same, more or less. And finally, or even maybe to start with, safe life versus fail-safe principle. So, to start with it, let us consider diagrams shown here. This one is not written in English, sorry for that, but I will explain what it is about. And basically, it is about the same as the one on the left hand side from your point of view. When I put here another significant change and improvement in engineering practice, I thought that the first one was just explained, accepted exception from the rules, Alaska to Central USA, but that was static. Now we consider dynamic conditions, more precisely fatigue, and once again we think about how to be sure that even if there is a crack, it will not reach the critical value before we can do something about it. So let's think about a limit of MDT as being somewhere here, let's say 1 millimeter. So that would be our crack length, crack size, MDT detection limit, somewhere here. Let's think about the initial point being right here at a certain time, and then let's think about how this crack would grow in a certain period of time. Those are dotted lines here or line presented here. If we know in a conservative way how the crack would behave, then we can say, let's have another MDT examination before this critical point is reached. It's still just abstract critical point, but let's be conservative. So let's have MDT somewhere in between the initial point and this point, let's say it's here. And then again, we have the same situation. If we do not find any defects, then we still have this limit of MDT, and once again, the same curve to the critical point. So unless we find any defect by MDT, we can do this as many times as we wish, endlessly, practically. Just keep NDT examination period inside the critical period. And that is fail-safe approach. So we even can assume that there is a defect. And based on that assumption, which is reasonably the limit of NDT, we can work it out this way in a fail-safe principle as contrary to safe life principle, which simply does not allow for any defects. In real life, of course, defects are always present. It's just a matter of how big they are. Is it nano, micro, or maybe macro? So, that principle was applied also in USA, and it saved about $1 billion in the case of jet engines. I don't know where it's written somewhere. What has enabled this fail-safe principle? It is material behavior sketched here. It is fatigue crack growth shown here, or better to say, separated here in three phases. Region one, non-continuum behavior. By that we practically say we don't know what's going on, but anyhow we know this curve. Then we have a constant crack growth rate in the second phase, continuum behavior, so we do know what's going on, more or less. And then finally,
we certainly don't want to come into the third region. Now, typical loading, typical stress is cyclic stress, not always this nice sinusoidal shape, but anyhow we can always reduce it to that case. So, Paris model is something that we still heavily rely on, and it basically correlates crack, fatigue crack growth rate with delta K and then some material parameters. This A is often C, this M is sometimes N, but it's the same material property or material parameter, to be more honest. Anyhow, the fact that Paul Paris correlated fatigue crack growth rate with stress intensity factor range was not recognized by some editors of famous journals for a long time, so he had to publish his initial paper in practically unknown journal and to make breakout by doing so. Delta K is of course a difference between K max and K min in the same way as sigma max and sigma min, so that's something that you can calculate or estimate. And then this relatively simple mathematical formula enables us to calculate or estimate the number of cycles from the initial crack, even if it does not exist, to the critical crack value. Some of it you have seen in my first presentation. So if everything is nicely constant, then we can make even some analytical integration and calculate it with simple calculator. We don't even need a computer for that. But in real life, we often have a need to numerically evaluate integrals like this. So if this geometrical correction factor depends on A, and it does, then we need to numerically integrate this to get NF. But anyhow, it's a simple task in that case, so we do have another important and simple engineering tool. Now this is the photo made last year in June in Catania, and that is Paul Paris. It was about half a year before he passed away, and that was certainly his last conference. He was the plenary and honorary speaker at the conference. So, let us see how this works in practical life. If we deal with pressurized welded pipes, you can see that that's my favorite topic. We should take into account the fact that they are usually made of some high strength steel or increased strength steels, and they are usually sensitive to cracking. So it is always important, especially having in mind consequences, at least with some pressure vessels, consequence of their failure could be a catastrophe. Just to remind you about, I think, 4,000 fatalities in India in 1984. It was carbon something factory and pressure vessels that exploded, and ammonia, I think, was leaked. It had leaked, and we definitely should not allow that to happen again. So we definitely need to better understand crack initiation and growth process. So in this case, it's not that important as for the consequence, because this is casing pipe used for oil drilling, for drilling to get oil, better to say. But its temperatures are somewhat increased, chemically aggressive environment for sure. And some problems which led us to have analysis about fatigue growth in this case. There was also an experiment done, irrespective of this analysis, for static loading.
with artificial crack as shown here just for illustration. What we did in the scope of the fatigue crack growth analysis was once again standard procedure for fatigue crack growth rate, testing and measurement, calculation of stress intensity factor range delta K. Yet again, it was standard Sharpie specimen with fatigue pre-cracked, 2 millimeters, and some of standard methods to follow to monitor its growth. Tests were done as in the already explained case, 3-point bending loading, which is, by the way, a conservative approach once again, because any other type of loading would produce lower rate of fatigue crack growth. And so we get a diagram which was sketched previously, and the one which is not so steep as the first one that I showed. So this is, how to say, reasonable behavior in respect to fatigue. You can see this initial period and then more or less this constant period before the third critical period and final failure. According to this data, we were capable of getting that coefficient which was marked by A and in this case marked by C. And I even don't remember why this index P stands there. But anyhow, we do have the value in yet another offered units, but useful. Then exponent and fatigue threshold. Fatigue crack growth rate, as given here, was just for a specific delta K. Otherwise, it depends on delta K and cannot be explicitly given. That was just for kind of illustration how, what is the order of magnitude. So by having all this data and by analyzing loading, which is maximum approximately 10 megapascals and minimum 7.89 with a certain temperature, not very much important, and by calculating using simple formula, once again cylindrical pressure vessel, we get a delta sigma, so stress range, of about 40 megapascals. Another data that we need later on is also number of strokes when we get to the point of evaluating the life, fatigue life. As for the crack, what we did have in a practical life was a crack which was about half of the thickness, which is 3.5 as compared to almost 7 millimeters of thickness, and then the length was 200 millimeters as shown previously here. So that was crack. So what do we need here? We need delta K, we need material properties, and then we need calculation of number of cycles for life. So some initial value and critical value of crack is what we need. Critical value, as explained, we can obtain by concept of linear elastic fracture mechanics according to K1C. And the initial value is either something that we have or something that we assume. In the second case, that would be a sensitivity or limit of NDT. Our case in this particular structural analysis was edge crack. That is how we represented what we have in real life, and that is also what is case here. Edge crack, well, in this case not in tension, but in bending. And in this case, if we make a cross-section, then we can think about edge crack, but in the tension. Anyhow, since three-point bending is
produces faster crack growth than tension, we are on the safe side if we consider also this. Testing has been done with tension.
So the point here is that we always should make conservative approach, and if we do that consistently for everything and we do get some, how to say, nice result, something like this will last for 35 years, as it will be the case, then we are sure we do not need to do anything about these eventual defects. So this is the equation. In that equation we can apply procedure just explained with the possibility to present a real life defect in a simple way, in some cross-section, and then get a simple fracture mechanics linear elastic analysis. With that, and being conservative at the same time, we are also in a position to apply relatively simple procedures. As I told you, this is more or less, at the end of the day, relatively simple engineering task. So, reliable but simple engineering tools have been developed so that you can use your calculator, but of course you should know what you're doing, and then get answers, as I told you, even without a computer. Then again, if you want some precise, more precise analysis, one of the options is of course to use finite element method, but don't forget it's just a black box. If you don't know what you're doing, you will get who knows what. GIGO, that is one acronym that I saw somewhere. Garbage in, garbage out. If input data is wrong, then don't even look at the output data. So, by using simple tools and calculators, you can get in this case critical crack length to be 14.4. For that, we have used K1C obtained from JR curve, so not that basic testing, but more advanced with elastic plastic approach, because this material is certainly not brittle. But anyhow, using J1C, we can get, as written here, about 91 megapascal square root meter, and to go back, when we put it here and take into account this simplified analysis with edge crack, we end up with 14.4. So now we can integrate and apply simple calculations for number of cycles, which turned out to be about 180 million cycles. And having in mind that number of strokes and number of hours, working hours, and so on, we can compare these two values and see at once that 180 should be divided by approximately 5, leading to almost 36 years. So that is for sure safe. No problem with that. Then again, if we want more precise analysis with different values of initial cracks and maybe different values with stress range, because we didn't take into account some possible effects, we can get even this three-dimensional presentation of remaining life. This point is the best that we can get. This is about 36 years, and all others are below or far below, but they are not very realistic anyhow. So in this case, we were quite satisfied with the analysis and didn't take any actions whatsoever. And finally, just let me check time. Application of non-linear fracture mechanics, and that application will be based on crack driving force as opposed to material resistance curves. It will be once again pressure vessel in question, and it will be shown in a bit more complicated manner how
non-linear fracture mechanics can be used even in the design phase of complicated construction. So this all started about 40 or even more years ago. It was during the construction of reversible hydroelectrical power plant Banja Bašta, which had a problem of designing and producing, constructing the pipeline, inlet pipeline, from the above lake, Zaovine, to the hydropower plant. In a cross section, you can see the length, you can see it here even better. And the problem was, should we use ordinary and most commonly used steel, but with only 350 megapascals of yield strength, and make two pipelines, because one could not handle the water, quantity of water, and the pressure, or should we use high-strength steel and prove somehow that with increased thickness, with a thickness which would not correspond to a design value, with thickness which is lower about 20% as far as I remember, something in 10 and 20, that it is still safe. What was the point? According to the design standards, the thickness should have been about 60 millimeters. And producer could make a vessel only with 47 millimeters. So extensive investigation was taken with the most important aspect being this prototype. This simulates the most stressed part of the pipeline. There is about 5% of an E as a stress concentration, and it was done in real dimension. You can see 4.2 meters and thickness 47. It was done by different welding processes, manual arc welding and submerged arc welding, and it was equipped with all kinds of different measuring devices, including strain gauges, COD gauge, acoustic sensor, and Moire grid. This experiment had been done in 1976. So today we would have done it a bit differently, but these are good old reliable methods. Artificial cracks were introduced so that we can analyze behavior, not only statically, as I will show, but also dynamically. There was even an explosion test to simulate so-called water hammer effect, but I will not present that. This is the team who did the experiment. It was some early month in 1976. This was the key man in the process, Professor Stojan Sedmak. And what we did was very basic application of crack driving forces versus JR curves. For crack driving forces, which are generally speaking to be calculated, we cannot measure them, because once we start loading our construction, crack would grow, even quasi-statically, and then we do not have fixed values. Crack driving forces are for fixed values of loading, and okay, loading can be increased, but crack should not grow. It's a bit artificial quantity, but it serves its purposes. Crack growth is actually covered by JR curve that we cannot calculate, but we have to measure. So those are two different sides of the equation. For the crack driving forces,
We used, in this case, Ratvani Erdogan-Irvin model, which is briefly given by a couple of equations here. What is important is that J integral is correlated with Krug dimension, besides being correlated with some basic material properties, and of course with all Krug dimensions and all relevant dimensions. So it is a proper, it is a measure of loading and geometry, and material properties, but not related to Krug growth. Material properties like modulus of elasticity and yield strength. On the other hand side, for the material behavior, different specimens were used. You already can recognize three-point bending, which is used for the most conservative estimation. And then again, in this case, since it was really a large construction, which is definitely under membrane stress as a cylindrical shell, that is just pure tension, almost no bending, there was another testing done on tensile panels. They are not standardized, but are definitely more realistic in this case. Nevertheless, our final judgment, conservative judgment, will be always with three-point bending specimens, but we keep in mind what is more realistic as well. So many experiments have been done. Three-point bending, panel tensile surface cracked, and many curves, JR curves, were obtained. Those that were relevant for our case are given here. So these are crack driving forces. Wherever you see this parameter, it means a ratio between stress and yield strength. So up to 93% is given here, and below to 50%. Now for the crack with a length which is 50% of the thickness, we position JR curves here, and for those which we call small cracks, which are quarter of the thickness, we position them here. And then they can indicate with this tangent point at which stress crack growth will become unstable. That's the critical point. As you can see, the worst case is here with 82% of yield strength. But even that worst case is as high as 82% of yield strength. You know, probably everybody, that we do accept and design our construction so that stress do not overcome 50%. So here, even with the crack which is half of the thickness, surface crack which is half of the thickness, we can go up to 82%. And everything is done in a conservative way. So definitely, the conclusion was that one pipeline could do the job. So it was made like that with all other results, like more classical Sharpe testing and so on. And it is now more than 40 years pipeline safely works. This was once again from Schmuck. And that is about the topics that I had. And I just want at the end to invite you for a brief discussion, if any. We have 2 or 3 minutes. Don't
we? Of course.
Yes. And also to invite you for the next 5th summer school in Belgrade, 26th and 27th of, no, 25th and 26th of August. And then, of course, for the European Conference on Fracture 22, which will follow. So, any questions?
If you have any questions, so please, we have maybe 1 minute, 1 or 2 minutes before lunch.
So.
So either everything was clear or nothing was clear.
Yeah. So and if you don't ask questions right now, you can do this during the break and discuss it. So yes, please.
I have one short question.
Yes, please.
You mentioned the finite element method. Have you used any numerical method and compared it to your analytical results for the case studies you showed? You mentioned it, so I hoped you would.
Yes,
but
yes, we did. And I have it also here. I think I can explain it fast. And that was in the example that I skipped over. So it was yet another pressure vessel. It was once again something that you can treat quite simple, but in this case, the pipe had something that we called color, some stiffener, okay, specially made, which are, as you can see here, modeled by thin shell elements. And by doing so, we could get more precise results for the stress. In that case, what we thought of being 144, if I remember well, reduced to 80. The point was that we could not guarantee safety of this construction with 144 megapascals, so we hoped that more precise analysis, which would be still conservative but less conservative, would enable us to get a better answer. But no, even with 80, it was still not, we could not prove that it would be safe. And then we also concluded that full three-dimensional finite element method would be even better to do, but probably not giving a big difference. But at the end of the day, interesting fact here is that owners of the pipeline did not obey to our conclusion. They left this construction with a defect, and they risked actually a lot, but it paid off. It was
It's still vulnerable.
It's still vulnerable. Even though we couldn't. Actually, our point was here, to be more concrete, here. You see, 0.63, 0.99. So just out of the scope, but it was obviously too conservative.
Thank you very much.